I appreciate everyone in the room for being on time, and I hope to see my colleagues in the near future. Is there a reason why this is echoing? Okay, good. Much better. Thank you. So good morning and welcome to this roundtable sponsored by the Senate Committee on Infrastructure and Capital Investment. My name is Elaine Phillips, and I represent the 7th Senate District in Nassau County, and I'm chair of the committee. I hope to be joined today by a number of my colleagues, including Senator Joe Robach of Monroe County, Chair of Transportation, Senator Marisol Alcantara of New York County, Chair of Labor, Senator Tom Croce of Suffolk County, who is a member of the committee, and Senator Tim Kennedy, the ranking chair for Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. And when they come in, I'll have them introduce themselves. Welcome to our other participants. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being on time. I will give you an opportunity to introduce yourselves shortly. I'm very pleased with the bipartisan representation that we will see on this panel, which includes representatives from across the state and with varied experiences and interest in this important topic. I hope that as a result of this discussion, we can all come to a better understanding of the governor's design-build proposal included in his executive budget. Right now, design-build is limited for use by just 5 agencies: the Department of Environmental Conservation, the Department of Transportation, New York State Bridge Authority, Office of Parks, Recreation, and Historic Preservation, and the Thruway Authority. And we've seen its use in a number of very high-profile projects for highway, bridge, and rail rehabilitation. And the largest project to date, the Thruway Authority, is using design-build in the $3.9 billion contract to replace the Tappan Zee Bridge. The legislative has also approved design-build on project-specific basis, including the Javits Center redevelopment in the last year's budget and the construction of the Onondaga Amphitheater in 2014, which was outside the budget. In his executive budget, the governor is seeking to permanently extend design-build beyond its expiration, which happens next month, and dramatically expand its use to every agency, including SUNY and CUNY, in every county outside the city of New York. It's the governor's belief that design-build can provide greater efficiency and savings on major projects. Today, I'd like to discuss the effectiveness of design-build over the past 5 years, its impact on jobs and the labor market, and very importantly, concerns that have been raised about the transparency of the process. Thank you again for joining me. At this time, I'd like to introduce my colleague, and then I will ask each of you to introduce yourselves. So, Senator Joe Robach.
Good morning. I am Joe Robach from the Rochester-Monroe County region, and I want to thank Senator Phillips for this. Obviously, something that goes on important as both a rank and file legislator and also as the chair of the Transportation Committee. So thank you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for being here. So, Ron, if we could start with you,
please. Sure. My name is Ron Epstein. I'm the Assistant Commissioner for Policy and Planning with the New York State Department of Transportation.
John Lewicki, I'm the Deputy Director for the OGS Design and Construction Group.
Molly Larkin, I'm the Executive Director of the OGS Design and Construction Group.
Paul Gendron, I'm representing PEP today, but I'm also Professional Engineer 1 with the Department of Transportation.
Hi, Josh Terry, Legislative Director, CSEA.
Hi, Maureen O'Donnell, Operating Engineers.
I'm Tracy Connolly on behalf of the New York State Building Trades.
Mike Elmendorf, President and CEO of the Associated General Contractors of New York State.
Brian Sampson, President of Associated Builders and Contractors of New York State.
Great. So I thought it might be nice, and my guess is you're all prepared, to give just a couple minute type of overview of what your opinion is, what your involvement is in design build, and ask that you keep it limited to a couple minutes, and then we'll start a conversation. And let me state, we chose the roundtable for a real reason. This is not a hearing. The intention is not to be a hearing. The intention is really to have a robust professional discussion on design build, the governor's proposal, and if and why we would want to change things going forward. So Juan, would you mind starting?
Sure, please. Assuming you can all hear me okay, I've never been accused of being shy, so.
Okay, good.
So first of all, again, thank you for having us here today. It's certainly a pleasure to talk about design build. We at DOT have utilized it, I believe, very effectively. And part of this is a larger context. Last year, with your strong support, DOT realized the first long-term transportation bill in more than a decade. And so basically, we've got about 2,500 projects in the plan over the next several years that we'll be delivering. And design build is an important part of the delivery mechanism for the program. And why is this important? Well, it's important for a number of reasons. Number one, it helps us with our economic competitiveness. We need to continue to make those investments around the state that help attract businesses and retain employees here. The plan itself will deliver more than 250,000 construction jobs. And then there is the induced employment that is associated with construction job spending. So it's very important that the jobs actually get out on the street. And I think it's important to note that also included in this year's budget, aside from design build extension, there's also a provision that would add an additional $1.2 billion for infrastructure projects across the state. Projects in, for instance, the Nassau Expressway on Long Island, the Kew Gardens Interchange in New York City, the Skagit in Western New York, and the Route 1732 Interchange reconstruction in the Hudson Valley. These were all projects that are going to benefit from acceleration as a result of the ability to use design build. So it's very important to recognize that there are projects in the book of projects that we have that will immediately get accelerated by years as a result of being able to deliver them sooner. Design build clearly is one of the best tools that we have to accelerate projects. But I do want to be clear, you know, since the bill was enacted in 2011, we've done 28 projects. As I mentioned, in our five-year plan, we have about 2,500 projects. So clearly design build is not the panacea for, you know, how do we do everything? And it's certainly not intended to replace traditional design bid build. It is a tool. We find it's a very effective tool. And there are some benefits that we utilize when we select projects for this technique. Now, the first thing is it allows us to select the best qualified teams, not only in terms of their experience on design, but also on construction. It also gives us a mechanism to take into account past performance, which I think is somewhat effective. If you want to deliver something quickly, you want to make sure in the end you're not going to run into problems with either, you know, orders on contracts as a result of issues that were raised between design and construction, or other reasons why project gets delayed. So you want to make sure that you're getting the best qualified firms for these particular projects. The other thing, it also helps effectively manage project risk, because basically the contractor is and the design team is taking on some risk when they enter into these agreements, so that we kind of end up with some cost certainty. The other thing is it does, it reduces the overall project duration. And what that does is it helps us with benefiting the public sooner, but also it minimizes the disruption to the public, so that, you know, a project that may take 3-4 years maybe gets delivered in 2. So basically what happens is the public's not inconvenienced by either the closure or the restrictions imposed by the construction. And as I mentioned, it gives us greater cost certainty, which is something I think we all strive for. As I mentioned, you know, this is not intended to replace traditional design bid build. I think that's evident by the number of projects that we have done compared to the number of projects we do on an annual basis. The governor, as you have mentioned, has proposed extending the design build legislation, making it permanent. I urge you to support that. And again, I want to stress that, you know, really this is a tool. We believe it's extraordinarily necessary to help us compete economically, as well as to create jobs around the state. So, you know, we at the department are willing to work with you and your members in the legislature to, you know, figure out a path forward in extending this important piece of legislation. Thank you.
If I could just take a second here and introduce my colleagues that have joined us. So, I've been joined by Senator Tim Kennedy, who is the ranking chair for Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Thank you for joining us. Senator Tom Croce of Suffolk County, who's a member of the committee, and Senator Comrie from New York County, from Queens, who has kindly joined us. So thank you very much.
I'm a member of the committee, too, I think.
And a member of the committee. Thank you, sir.
It is Monday morning.
Not excluding you from that committee. Thank you. So we're just taking a few minutes and going around and just giving a little overview. So John, if you can continue there, please.
Senator, I'll defer my comments to Molly. We have a
prepared introduction,
please.
Thank you. Good morning, Senator Phillips and members of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Thank you for asking us to join in your discussion about the design-build process and related proposals in the executive budget. Again, my name is Molly Larkin. I'm the Executive Director of OGS Design and Construction, and with me, I have my Deputy Director, John Lewicki. The OGS Design and Construction Group provides architectural, engineering, contracting, emergency contracting, and construction management services to over 50 state agencies and authorities. Our clients include Department of Corrections and Community Supervision, Office of Children and Family Services, and New York State Police, among many. Our team is made up of 300 people with approximately 100 licensed professional engineers and registered architects on staff. Acting as New York State's architect, DNC has a current workload of $700 million in active construction projects and $1 billion in design development. Our average construction contract size is just under $1 million. However, the contracts we bid range anywhere from $50,000 to above $150 million. Under current laws, OGS is unable to utilize design-build to deliver our projects. We believe that changing this law and allowing OGS to utilize design-build when appropriate will result in substantial savings to New York State taxpayers, minimize project risks, and give us the ability to deliver capital projects much faster. OGS is not currently authorized to use design-build, but after Superstorm Sandy, Governor Cuomo issued an executive order that allowed us to use design-build on a particular project for the Office of Mental Health, and we learned firsthand how much this project delivery method could benefit the people of the state of New York.
How large of a project was that? Do you remember?
50 million, about 50 million. On October 29th, 2012, Superstorm Sandy hit the mid-Atlantic coast, causing storm surges of 12 to 14 feet in parts of New York City. OMH's South Beach Psychiatric Center is located on Staten Island in the floodplain of the Eastern Shore. The storm took out electrical power for a prolonged period, caused flood-related damage to most all of the inpatient housing buildings, and caused major damage to the basement of Building 8 and 9 on the campus, which supported patient programs, essential campus support facilities, including administration, food service, IT, and maintenance workshops. All the mechanical and electrical services for Building 8 and 9 were located in the basement of the building and were completely submerged by the salt water storm surge. Approximately 350 OMH clients, 38 OASIS clients, and 840 OMH employees were displaced because of Superstorm Sandy damage and the South Beach Psychiatric Center. Today, a newly completed, flood-resistant, 40,000-square-foot, two-story central services building at the South Beach Psychiatric Center now houses the essential campus functions lost as a result of the storm. In the case of South Beach campus, the design-build contracting method offered a quick and cost-effective response to an emergency need. This fast-track project delivery method reduced overall project schedule, increased flexibility to address the program changes, reduced professional and construction management fees, and reduced construction costs related to contractor overhead. For the CSB, design-build reduced the project schedule by 21 months. Saved taxpayers approximately $1 million on emergency mechanical and electrical equipment rental costs and $1.5 million in construction management and professional fees, and allowed for the physical completion of the new facility just 2 years after Superstorm Sandy. Again, we believe that allowing OGS to utilize design-build when appropriate will result in substantial savings to New York State taxpayers, minimize project risks, and the ability to deliver critical projects much faster. We thank you for your time, and we would be happy to answer any questions when we get to that part of the program.
Great. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning. On behalf of Public Employees Federation, thank you for the opportunity to speak to everyone. So PEF represents about 3,800 engineers, architects, technicians, and various professional and scientific titles. As an observer of design build over the last 4 or 5 years, we've developed several concerns of how it's been used, particularly within the DOT. The first issue that is overarching would be related to construction inspection. On typical projects, a contractor does his work and it's inspected by DOT employees and or consultant construction inspection employees who have supervision by the DOT. In all design-build contracts, construction inspection is hired by the design firm, and the DOT is taken out of the loop. There's great concerns of lack of transparency and accountability. And it's gotten to the point where on certain jobs, there's reports of the inspectors telling DOT personnel who are observing or who have some role that they work for the construction contractor, not the DOT. So there's no interaction. Second concern is the use of bundling to design and build projects. We understand that there's might be a use for design build when a large project, $50 million or above. But when it comes down to small projects such as deck replacements or paving, threshold of $1.2 million is what we call unrealistic, not beneficial, not a cost savings. So you're losing transparency and you're losing cost effectiveness. We also believe that even though design build is shown to or claimed to save time, that the typical design bid build process, where there's a separate designer and a separate builder, there's ways to speed up projects. They would include using precast concrete, ordering steel in advance, doing multiple shifts, increasing overtime, and using PLAs in advance to properly speed up the work. And there's opportunity to accelerate environmental procedures. So between those processes, you could come close, or maybe in some cases exceed the time savings in design build. I'd also like to mention that there are concerns with quality. Going back to the construction inspection, issues of quality. The most famous one goes back to the Big Dig and in Boston, where a tunnel there was a collapse due to proper inspection and led to a death. I guess lastly, I'd like to mention the report that came out last fall related to the bill that was passed 2 years ago. In that report, as far as cost savings, when it came to those five projects that were in the report, three of them had no cost savings to be determined yet. So PEF believes at this time it wouldn't be prudent to extend a permanent bill. Further research is necessary, and further analysis could be done based on costs that eventually come in for these projects. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Phillips, good morning, committee. My name is David Veroli. I'm with the City of New York, and I truly appreciate the opportunity to speak in front of you. New York City, like my colleagues in the state, are also asking for the ability to have design build. We believe it is time to modernize procurement for the city, and the first step would be to increase one of our tools. Right now, we only have one tool, and that tool is design, bid, and build. And as my colleague from State DOT, PEF, has just mentioned, talking about time and places to find savings, let me just briefly describe to you how it currently works. If I have a project, and New York City has a lot of projects, we have a lot of needs. If I want to bring on a firm to actually design that project, I have to do procurement. The procurement time period to bring on a design team is anywhere for a small project to a large project, anywhere from 1 to 2 years. And that's if everything goes well. The contractor, the vendor, the professional design firm has no responsibility issues, no federal issues, no state issues, no city issues. Everything flies by. That's following all the steps and rules and procedures. So right there, that's a 2 year period. Then it comes time to do the actual design. The design itself is anywhere from 1 to 2. It could even be 3 years, again, depending on the complexity. If we're talking a very large bridge or an infrastructure road project or a police precinct or firehouse, some of the projects that I work on, this can take anywhere from 1, 2, or 3 years. They finish their design. Now the next step, we do a procurement to bring on a construction firm. That procurement alone, again, can take anywhere from 1 to 2 years. And the time considerations that go into it is you need to evaluate and determine whether or not the bid was responsive. And once you get past that hurdle, you need to then determine if the bidder was responsible. And that alone has, and I have seen personally firsthand, where we've had non-responsible vendors that have really stopped or slowed down the process. So in sketching this all out, we're looking at anywhere from 2 to 3 years to bring on the design team. We're looking at another 2 years to bring on the construction team. That's 5 years of time spent with no project being built. And so what design build does, and I think state DOT has shown that, and you know, I also read the report that came out in the fall. It was in August of 2016 from the Empire State Development Corporation. I thought they did a great job. I thought they analyzed it perfectly. You are saving so much time. And getting to the money, I've heard different criteria. I've heard 6%, I've heard 10%. At the end of the day, we know there's gonna be a savings in time and there'll be a savings in money. In New York City, we're actually seeing the benefit of design build today from our colleagues at state DOT. There's a bridge that's going on in Queens, which is flying. It's unbelievable. And if you were ever on the roadway to get to that bridge, you would understand and know and want that project to be done sooner than later. And that's what design build does for you. I'm looking forward to seeing how the Javits Center goes. We already know what's happening with the Tappan Zee Bridge. I mean, we have real records of what is happening in the state. And you know, design build is not a new concept. I wish it was, and I wish we were here talking about something really new and creative, but the reality is it's not. It's been around for a really long time. I've done some research. I'm a bit of a geek this way. It goes back over 100 years. And then we kind of moved away from it and got into this world of design, bid, build. But we're now coming back. And for the last 25 years, the federal government and now all 50 states have some form of design, build. I won't take too much time to talk about the city's needs, but the city's infrastructure is incredibly aging. We have water mains that are over 75 years old. We have bridges that are over 75 years old. We have needs that can only be dealt with if we have this tool. And as my colleague from DOT said, it's not a panacea. It really isn't. But it's one extra tool in our toolbox. And right now our toolbox is pretty empty. And our needs are so great that any ability we have to do procurements and construction times faster, then I think we have to. Because at the end of the day, we are all taxpayers, and we represent the taxpayers. And they need to be able to know that their money is being spent wisely and that their projects are being delivered fast. Because how many times have we heard the criticisms of the construction industry and government itself in trying to deliver public improvement projects? We're always too slow. We always cost too much money. Well, the reality is some of that is true. But if we have a tool like design build for those critical projects, and I guess I would kind of dispute the issue of cost, because I've recently been working on two projects, one that I just completed and one that I hope to complete by the fall of this year. One was for a domestic abuse center in Staten Island, the only borough that did not have a domestic abuse center. If I had design build, I could have been in and out of that project within 15 months. But without it, it took almost 2 to 3 years to get that project done. And that's not something that should ever happen. In addition, I'm working on currently a health clinic in the Chelsea section of Lower Manhattan. Again, this is a project that should be done and it should be completed. And if we had the opportunity to do design build, we believe we would have been done and out of that project, and the people who need those services would be able to use that facility. So, and again, in the end, it comes to me back to the time, the savings, the money, the taxpayers. Design build is a tool to allow us to achieve more. We still will be doing design bid build. We would love to have design build. We would love to deliver better services for the residents, the businesses, as also the tourists who come to our great city. Thank you again for your time.
David, Can I just ask a question? On those two projects that you specifically mentioned, yes. What are the size of those projects?
The Staten Island Domestic Abuse Center was about $2 million. $2 million. The Chelsea Health Clinic, I believe, is about $5 million.
And New York City doesn't have the ability to request project-specific basis? A design build on a project-specific basis?
We don't have the state authorization
to request design build.
Right.
New York City has been excluded.
Right.
Even on a project-specific. You know what? It's me interrupting, and we're going to let them go through, but I agree. Whoa. I'm not following my own rules, basically. Thank you. Yeah, thanks. This is what I deal with now.
Good morning. As I said, my name is Joshua Terry, and I'm the legislative director for the Civil Service Employees Association. I want to be clear before we start that CSEA does not oppose design build on its face. We do not oppose it out of hand. As a few other people have said, we agree that it is a tool for certain projects that the state is undertaking. But what we do oppose is blanket authority for design build projects in state and local governments. We can support and we have supported design build projects in the past. However, these are specifically authorized in state law on a project-by-project basis with oversight from the Senate and the Assembly and then the governor. These project-by-project laws have appropriate transparency and accountability to taxpayers, clear authorization and prohibition that public assets, clear authorization that public assets will remain public, that they'll be maintained by public employees where appropriate, and they will not be operated by private companies, corporations, or entities. Lastly, we need to ensure that these projects protect against the loss of public sector jobs. And they must also include a sunset clause when the project is finalized. Based on these conditions, which we've long held, these are not new issues for us, we've long held these standards on projects, we oppose the executive's proposal in this budget to permanently extend and to extend to local governments and all state agencies and public authorities. There's a trust gap with the public right now. I think the elections in the fall showed that we have a problem with the public trusting what's happening in government at this point. And design build, when it's not done on a project-by-project basis, can add to that mistrust. We need to ensure that all these projects are done on the up and up, that they are very clear and transparent on who's getting the project bid, why they got it, and in the metrics that they were able to get it, or why they got it. So I liked your idea of being able to get out of here early, so I'm going to end my notes on that, and I'll take any comments after, or questions after.
Thanks, Josh.
Hi, Maria. Hi, hello, everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak today on behalf of 30,000 members of New York State, 13 state locals of the International Union of Operating Engineers. We want to express our strong opposition to design build and the governor's proposal in the transportation budget. One of the principal objections to design build is that enforcement and oversight of labor protections is tied to competitive bidding laws. The design build circumvents competitive bidding laws, which provide for transparency and public oversight of the contracting process and puts these essential labor protections at risk. State and local contracts for public works should be awarded through a competitive bidding process designated to ensure fairness, weed out corruption, and provide an even playing field for bidding contracts. When taxpayer dollars are funding a project, the public has a right to expect a fair process to ensure that public money is spent appropriately. Government is supposed to guarantee a fair process. Unfortunately, design build, which essentially eliminates competitive bidding, does not guarantee that fair process. Rather, design build weakens transparency and partially need to protect taxpayers and workers. A true competitive process does provide that public accountability. Design build simply makes it easier for bids that may not reflect the true cost of a project to be approved because design build awards contract on a subjective basis of best value as opposed to more objective as lowest responsible bidder. Since design-build contracts can be let without requiring it to be awarded to the lowest responsible bidder, the process lends itself to potential corruption. It is too easy to award a project to a favored contractor. A further problem with the proposal is one of the particular concern of the operating engineers and working men and women across New York, is the proposal includes no labor protections like PLAs. Now we agree on a limited circumstances design build may make sense. In those instances, New York State has the ability to approve these projects with appropriate work protections and transparency through legislation on a case-by-case basis. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. One of the things I wanted to start out with is by recognizing that when we talk about design build, there's actually three separate elements involved, because design build is merely the project delivery mechanism, right, that combines the contracts. But we also have the selection process, which, as Marina just mentioned, is done on a design build basis, is done on best value basis with design build, where traditionally in New York State with design bid build, we do have the lowest responsible bidder approach. The other element that I think is worth noting is the type of contract that gets awarded in the end. And I'm talking about, I think in the current authorization, we can either do a lump sum contract or a cost plus with a gross maximum price contract. And each of these elements has pros and cons. So I think before doing a broad authorization, we need to look at each of those individually. I can understand how design build can possibly save some time off of a project, and I get that a public owner likes the fact that the risk can be shifted, but those benefits can come with costs. Sometimes when we fast track a project, there could be unforeseen problems down the road. As we heard mentioned already, I think when you combine the designer and the contractor onto the same team, you lose some of the checks and balances that ordinarily exist between the two. With traditional design, bid, build, construction, the designer remains independent and in essence protects the owner from a contractor who may try to cut corners. I mean, that designer's primary goal is to protect the integrity of his design. When you have them, the designer and the contractor on the same team, that designer is no longer looking out for the owner's best interest, but is concerned about the bottom line of the team. Also, by combining the two contracts, I think the owner sometimes may lose some flexibility in choosing how the project gets done. For example, they may like the design that comes with Team A, but then by default, they're stuck with the contractor that's on Team A, where they may actually prefer the contractor on Team B because of history with projects, and maybe they could do it for a lower cost. The potential for quality control issues also comes up because of the way the risk of the project is shifted with design build. For example, with a lump sum contract, the design builder is obligated to complete the project for an agreed upon price. If that contractor starts incurring cost overruns, he's going to look for ways to make up for those overages. So whether or not he's going to start cutting corners, he may, you know, quality could suffer, he could opt for inferior products or possibly even cheaper labor. Another concern that is that design build ends up reducing competition. The cardinal principle of public bidding is that each bidder should have an equal opportunity to compete for the contract. But the process of shortlisting with the design-build contracting freezes out certain contractors. And furthermore, small to medium-sized contractors are often squeezed out of the process because they simply can't bankroll the proposal and shoulder the risk associated. It's very time-consuming to put together a design-build project. You have to have a lot of your pieces put together ahead of time, and small contractors simply can't do it. With respect to the selection process of actually awarding the contract with best value, you have the selection criteria, the factors that are all scored. The problem with this method is that it's purely subjective, and that subjectivity jeopardizes the integrity of the selection process. New York started adopting competitive bidding laws over 170 years ago, and they were done in response to they were a series of reforms to temper abuse within the public contracting system. Over time, additional pressures led to the adoption of the lowest responsible bidder standard because they needed to protect against favoritism, fraud, and corruption in the award of public contracts. The best value nature of design build, however, sends us back to this pre-reform era where a subjective scoring system could potentially mask improper motives and practices. With lowest responsible bidder, you are protected against fraud and bias because your award is based on one number, the lowest bid. With a subjective best value approach, you create a window that where personal ideologies can creep into the process and allow contracts to be steered towards or away from particular contractors. With lowest responsible bidder, you are promoting transparency because you have sealed bids which are publicly opened. With the subjective best value method, you invite temptation to manipulate the scores or the scoring criteria to achieve a desired result. As a labor organization, the building trade's primary goal is to protect the men and women who work here, and our major concern with design build is that it provides for less government oversight, which puts workers at risk. If the state's comfortable with that equation, the risk-benefit equation, we would insist that the law be structured to protect labor. There needs to be a mechanism in place to offset the possibility that whether if there's cost overruns and they're looking to make up for those overages, that it doesn't come back and translate to cheap labor. That mechanism would be a project labor agreement. The certainty that comes with a PLA would also, I would think, be beneficial to a design-build entity, because what PLAs do is it standardizes the terms and condition of the contract, so that design builder who is shouldering the risk for the project is going to have a pretty absolute number as to what his labor is going to cost. He's going to know that there won't be delays, there won't be strikes. That should help him in doing his bid. A PLA would also be a necessity on vertical design build projects. So if we're moving away from roads and bridges and we're talking about construction of buildings, a PLA is the only way to get around the WICS law. Even if you have a design build statute that attempts to preserve WICS, it can't really be done effectively. For example, the executive's proposal says that the public owner would satisfy his duty under WICS by requiring the design builder to prepare the separate specs, but it leaves out the other components of WICS, which is the lowest responsible bidder requirement and the sealed bid requirements. Moreover, the limited government oversight associated with design build would make it virtually impossible to enforce. It's important to remember that the proposal that's on the table put forth by the governor not only expands design build to every state agency and authority and county outside of New York City, it also makes it permanent. Now, some agencies may be able to effectively determine which projects, like DOT mentioned 28 out of thousands of them. Not every agency is going to be so sophisticated to be able to figure out what kinds of projects are most appropriate for design build, and especially if you're now talking at the county level, I just don't think you're going to have that kind of sophistication. The building trades urges that you weigh the costs associated with any benefits that may ensue with this authorization. We think that the lack of transparency associated with the best value design build contracting system is contrary to the state's policy. And if the state wants to move projects along faster, maybe we should focus our attention on how to make the lowest responsible bidder design bid build system work better. I mean, why don't we let's improve upon something that works instead of going backwards in time to the pre-reform era?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning, Senator. Thank you to you and your colleagues for not only convening this conversation, but for including us. I'm Mike Elmendorf from the Associated General Contractors of New York State. We're New York's leading statewide construction industry association. We represent contractors in every region of the state, a mix of both heavy highway civil contractors that perform work for DOT, the Thruway, and agencies like that, as well as the vertical construction industry. Our membership is about an even split between union and non-union contractors, so we basically have everyone in the industry under one tent. And we've had a lot of experience with design build and our membership since 2011. It's really kind of been a going concern for the DOT. There hasn't been a lot of activity outside of DOT. Obviously, you've got the Tappan Zee Bridge, but that's sort of an entity unto itself. So the real world experience for us as an association and as an industry has been largely with DOT projects. And I would tell you it's been a very good experience. When this change happened in 2011, it was a sea change in terms of not only how our industry and our contractors do business, but how the department does business. And I think the way in which the department and the industry have partnered together to learn, to develop the process, to make the process better, more efficient, more responsible, has been a real success story. There's no question that it has allowed the industry and the department to deliver projects in a way and in a time frame that would not have happened without having this authority. So simply from the perspective of what's been out there, what has the track record been, I think it has been a great success for the industry, for the men and women who work in the industry, but more importantly for the people of the state who have had projects delivered that they wouldn't have or had them done sooner. Now, a couple of things I want to address. Folks and even proponents of design build talk about it in terms of it produces savings. It may produce savings, or it may not. The benefit may be that it allows you to complete a project sooner, whether it's getting in the ground, getting started on the project sooner, or having a plan and a design that completes construction sooner, which obviously benefits the owner, benefits the taxpayer, benefits the public. It may be that because you have the ability to look at competing designs, that a team comes in with a proposal that lasts a lot longer.
designing a bridge that lasts 50% longer than your competitor. And that's why you have a process where you have not only an evaluation of the price that design build team puts together, but a technical score that a team of experts within the agency puts together that are compared side by side based on the rules that are in place to determine who the best value is for the taxpayer. You know, the idea that some have that this is sort of some new thing and is this a good idea, should we be doing this, it sort of makes me chuckle because, as you heard from others, the rest of the country has been doing this for a good long time. You know, we're kind of in the dark ages here. It'd be like sitting around saying, I don't know, color TV. I'm not sure if we should get that. The rest of the country has done this for many, many years with great success. There's a proven track record. This is a tool that agencies and units of government all across the country have. It's one of many, by the way. It's not, as others have said, a panacea. It's not appropriate for every project. It needs to be a project that's sufficiently complicated. It needs to be a project that has in it the ability to look at different technical designs and different aspects that can make it worth a more complicated, more expensive procurement, not only for the agency, but for the contractor. The contractors spend a lot of time and money, as do their partners in the design firms, putting together these proposals for jobs they may not get. And so it needs to be the type of project where the benefit of that more complicated process makes sense. But, you know, for instance, in terms of the current proposal, expanding it to all agencies, you know, we would argue that for vertical construction, design build could be helpful for some projects, but there's other things that should be considered, like CMC, construction manager as constructor. It's also known as CM at risk. There's a proposal that we have out there on that front that I think should be talked about in terms of a broader conversation about project delivery, because that's really what this is about. How can we do the work that we as an industry do, that our partners in the public sector do, more efficiently, more effectively, get things done sooner? Because as so many have said, there are a lot of needs out there. You know, and last year we were here partnered with most of the people around the table, including our friends in the building trades, working very hard with a lot of support from the Senate to get a significant increase to the DOT's capital plan. It was a big victory for everyone. Without design build, the ability of DOT, and we're talking a lot about DOT because this again is where the design build action has been, their ability to deliver the type of meaningful projects that we would all like to see in terms of real reconstruction of the state's infrastructure, which is falling apart from Long Island to the North Country to Buffalo, is going to be very, very severely curtailed if they don't have the ability to go forward with design-build projects, because they don't have a thick design shelf. There's a lot of things they know they need to do, and to go out and take the time to design it in-house and go through that process is going to make it much more difficult for them to deliver those projects within the current plan. You know, a couple things I want to respond to, which I guess is the advantage of sitting on this end of the table. You know, I was interested in Paul's comments about the construction inspection. Our understanding from the experience that our contractors have had is that those construction inspectors report to DOT. It's a standard process. It's not the Wild West taking place out on job sites, and you know, there is accountability. And by the way, as others have pointed out, there's an enormous amount of additional risk that the contractor takes in a design-build procurement. That project is on them. They are obligated to deliver the project. They're not cutting corners. The designers aren't cutting corners. They're held to the same professional standards of the design profession that you know, that they would normally be held to. This is, again, something that is an experience that's taking place around the country. It's been happening in New York for a very long time on private vertical construction activities, so this is not some new crazy idea that we're trying to determine, gee, is this something that we should be doing or not? It is absolutely something that we should be doing. And finally, and I can only imagine that Brian's going to have something to say about this one, you know, but the question of project labor agreements. You know, I appreciated the comment that all bidders should have an opportunity to propose and participate in these projects. We agree with that, which is why we oppose mandated project labor agreements. And when I say we, I'm not talking about the 50% of our members who are non-union contractors. I'm talking about our whole membership, because our union contractors oppose them as well, clearly for different reasons than the non-union guys do. But it's first of all, really has nothing to do with whether you deliver a project by design build or traditionally by design bid build, a PLA. They are not germane to each other. They've become that because it's sort of been what this discussion has devolved to, and I think it's unfortunate because I think design build is good for all of us in terms of being able to get work out onto the street. But to be clear, and it's not an academic point, it's a real-world experience point, If you have a project labor agreement on these projects, you will exclude about half of the heavy highway industry from participating. You will exclude vertical building contractors from participating in projects if it's extended to OGS and the other agencies that do construction. It's not conjecture, it's happened. There have been real world examples on design build projects where you had the decision made to mandate a PLA after the firms had already been shortlisted, and two of the four firms that were shortlisted, who happened to be non-union contractors, immediately withdrew from the procurement after there was a PLA mandate determined, after they had spent all that money to get to that point with their design firm. And by the way, by withdrawing, they were no longer eligible for the stipend that you get if you're deemed to have submitted an adequate proposal if you're not selected. There's a stipend paid that helps defray some of the costs that the contractor and design firm incur, again, a standard practice. So, you know, let's not mix apples and oranges here. We believe in fair and open competition. I don't disagree with our partners in the building trades, and we really are partners. We agree on a lot of things. You'll see us together walking around talking about investment and things like that. Like most partners, we don't agree on everything. There are ways that I think this process can be improved, and as I said, it's been improved every year with the experience we've had so far with DOT. Every year that we've been doing this, DOT has sat down with industry and with contractors that have worked on these projects to say, what went well? What didn't go well? What can we do better? We certainly have ideas on how we can improve this process. And, you know, one final point that I would add, we support the executive budget proposal. I think that there is some concern about the extension of it to local governments, because obviously you've got varying degrees of complexity in local governments. You have some counties that are big, they deliver big programs, they have a lot of very experienced people. You have other counties that are smaller, more rural. This is like giving them a sports car, right? If you're used to driving a Buick and suddenly somebody hands you a Lamborghini, it might not go very well. So I think that one of the things that the legislature really should look at is that piece of this. And I think if it is going to be extended to local governments, because clearly they can use it, as some have pointed out, there have been project-specific instances where localities have been given the authority. There should be some sort of training or education process for those counties so that they can get this right and make sure that they're doing it in a way that maintains transparency, that delivers value to the public and the taxpayer, and that stays, keeps everything on the up and up.
Thank you.
Good morning, Senator. Now you understand why I don't like to share a microphone with him. So I'm Brian Sampson. I'm president of Associated Builders and Contractors. We represent over 400 merit shop or non-union construction firms across the state of New York. And I could simply carry on with what Mike said, but I will echo everything that he said. From our position on design build, I have been working in the design build industry for over a decade. I was the former executive director of the Design Build Institute of New York. So I'm very familiar with how it works and what it can do to benefit the state of New York. And I think given where we're at today with our infrastructure needs, our roads, our bridges, our water, our sewer, we don't have the ability to continue to squander opportunities. Dollars are tighter. What design build provides is that opportunity to look at things a little bit differently and a little bit more smartly in how we deliver those projects. But to Mike's point, deliver them so that they're going to last longer. I think when you're looking at roads and bridges under a traditional design bid build type of model, where you're going with low cost, you may get a product that isn't as good as it could be, because you have to win on your low bid. But if you're winning based on cost, you can put different products in there, you can do different delivery techniques into that bid, which we think will benefit our infrastructure in the long run. So we think design build is good. As far as the governor's proposal, I think by and large we support it. We believe there are some things that can be done to make it better from a transparency standpoint, from an education standpoint with local governments. We believe there are some things that we could put in there that will make it stronger and make people more comfortable with it. Where we sort of diverge with the governor is the mandated PLA studies. We are adamantly opposed to project labor agreements on a whole host of reasons, not the least of which is it will restrict competition. And when you restrict competition, you decrease the value of the product that you're ultimately going to get while increasing the cost of it. The second thing that we have with project labor agreements is when you're negotiating a PLA, you cannot negotiate the cost of the project based on the product that is going into it. The PLA is negotiated on the backs of the workers. So if we're really into making sure that workers are protected, which I think we all are, we shouldn't ask them to give up wages. We shouldn't ask them to give up benefits. If a PLA is going to work, it should work on the merits of the PLA, not on the backs of the workers. So let's protect the workers, move forward with the design process, let everybody bid. Best bid wins. We think that's the right way to go for New York State. I'm sure we'll have lots of other different questions that we can answer for you, but we believe extending design build is the right approach. We believe making it permanent is the right approach. 36 or 38 other states are already doing it. It's time for New York to catch up. And we know we can do this in a way. We have the right people in government. We have the right people at the local level. We have the right contractors and certainly the right labor market to get it done. So thank you.
Thank you. So just to reintroduce my colleague, Senator Kennedy, who's the ranking on the committee, Senator Croce's on the committee, Senator Robach, Chair of Transportation, and Senator Comrie, who I didn't mean to exclude off the committee, but he's on the committee, so it's good to have them here. I just want to remind, and if my colleagues want to make a statement, this would be a good time, but I want to remind everybody when we do start discussion, it really is discussion. So questions aren't just from us to you. It can be this way, too. So, Senator Kennedy, would you?
Sure. First of all, Chairwoman, thank you for hosting this, my colleagues, and to all of the speakers. We appreciate you being here and sharing with us your thoughts on the design-build process, what's been proposed, what's been in use in the past, and what we can do to make it better. Obviously, we're all paying very close attention to what has been proposed in the budget, and we're hearing both positive and negative. I think a lot of that has been made abundantly clear here this morning already. And quite frankly, I'm looking forward to bouncing some of the questions that I've heard come from you this morning off of each other to see if we can come forward with a strong compromised solution that works for everybody, if that's possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Croce.
Well, thank you very much, Senator. I appreciate you getting all these minds in the room. This is how we come up with good public policy. I was struck by some of the testimony here and some of it going back to Superstorm Sandy and the very specific powers given to executive branch agencies and executives to really accomplish the goal of rebuilding after something that devastating. And that's why the emergency powers are there. But I also heard a lot of testimony about the subjective nature of this, the transparency issues, competitive bidding, pre-reform era. And I'm just wondering how we come up with a public policy that complements our other public policies. I would not want to see anything that we do going forward to short-circuit the minority women-owned business contracts that are leted out, the service-disabled veteran process as well. I would not want to see anything we do jeopardize that, so that's something I think we need to keep in strong consideration as we go forward, and I look forward to the conversation.
Great. Senator Roper.
Yes, thank you for having this. I would just say briefly, so you could tell there's certainly some commonality, but not. I come from a little bit of a different lens, so we've been in a lot of dialogue with the governor and the department that per the agreement of last year, a six-year capital plan, where the MTA, with a lot of help of people in this room, a lot of my colleagues, matched a $27 billion plan. From my accounts, about $4.2 billion a year should be going out the door. I see that plus, again, going out for the MTA, which I'm not against, but I don't see that for roads and bridges. And so we want to work to that point. So in that larger picture, for me, in response to many of my constituencies and my colleagues who are concerned with work in the aging infrastructure in their area, this becomes critically important. And I don't know if this was the right time, and I'm not even sure who to ask. So You know, I think first and foremost, I would say you people have much more expertise than we do on a daily basis. So it was surprising to me because where I live, to build a building wouldn't take that long. So I don't know if there's some additional requirements in New York City coupled with the states. But I think to that point, even though while we're here for design build, if there are any other things that I guess I would call red tape or regulations in getting work out the door that aren't controversial in any way, but take up time, I think we should discuss those in the greater picture, because I think we should get to a process where things are sort of done in advance, certain things are required and expected, and then I think that could become the norm. The hard part is getting to exactly what that should be. So to that question, I never understand, and I really don't, if everybody is competing for the same thing, we know we have prevailing wage. Why is the PLA such a killer for people to compete regardless of what label they are or how they do business?
So the primary reason in the PLA that is objectionable to the merit shop community is that it requires that 3 out of every 4 workers come from the local union hall. So I, as a merit shop contractor who have invested hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars in salary and benefits and training to my workers, why would I bid a job where 3 out of every 4 of my workers can't go to work on the job on a project that their tax dollars are subsidizing?
Right.
So that's the big reason. The second reason is that let's say you do have someone who will bid the PLA, a merit shop contractor that bids it, because some do, it's their choice. For each of their workers that goes on the job, there are benefits that are paid to the local hall, union wages and other benefits. That worker never gets those, they stay. So all that time and energy that they've put into building that project, there's benefits that have gone to the hall that they don't get, and that's not right.
And I, Senator, if I can just add from the perspective of the union side of the industry, because as you might imagine, with our membership being what it is, you would think people might start throwing plates at each other when this topic comes up. And again, it's not the case. Our union contractors oppose the mandated PLAs as well, because it undermines their collectively bargained agreements with the trades that they've worked with in some cases for generations. They're their partners, they're their workforce, and they sit down and they bargain an agreement. But when you have the specter of mandated PLAs out there,
Wouldn't that become the PLA? That's why.
No, because the
I'm
PLA.
I'm confused because even in our group in Rochester, some people, they're all in the same group. Some are for it, some are against it, because they say this is our culture and what we always do. And there's a lot of dialogue about keeping the jobs local.
The PLA is a deviation from the agreement that the contractor and the trades have. It offers up something to theoretically provide savings that then justify the PLA. And what that does is for the contractors, when they're sitting at the table with their partners in the trades negotiating an agreement, you have things that are off the table, right? That should be subject to collective bargaining. If they benefit the project, if they speed the project along, if they provide savings, that should be part of the agreement that all the union contractors use all the time so that they can go out and more successfully compete for the work. And there's a difference between a PLA and a mandated PLA. We don't oppose PLAs. In fact, our association does the labor negotiation for the heavy highway side of the industry north of Dutchess, basically, right? And then you have the local groups down there that do it. And so we bargain with the unions. We have a good relationship with the unions. This is one of the things we don't agree on. But what we have done, though, is we have negotiated voluntary PLAs that our union contractors have used to help them compete more successfully for a project. And you know what? Sometimes they use that agreement and they get the work, and sometimes they use the agreement and they still don't get the work.
Right.
That's how it works. That's a competitive process. So we're not anti-PLA. We're certainly not anti-union. Half of our members, are longtime union firms. But it just creates a multitude of problems for everyone.
Point out that Mr. Sampson, first of all, in his remarks originally stated that PLAs are negotiated on the backs of workers. The New York State building trades and the local unions represent the workers, okay? The ABC and the AGC represent the contractors, not the workers themselves. So I think that's an important distinction when you're talking about who's negotiating on behalf of the workers. It's also not necessarily true that 3 out of every 4 workers have to be hired from the union hall. That number is usually based on market share, and it differs throughout the state. In Buffalo, it's usually 1 and 1. So it just depends on how it gets negotiated. As far as the benefits going into the union, that is really no longer the case on a standard basis. Now, if a non-union contractor has benefits and pensions that he offers his workers, they can pay that money into their own program. They're not forced to pay into the union and then, you know, into their own programs. That would increase cost overall. We don't require it any longer. And one reason that non-union contractors, including MWBEs, are learning that they like bidding work under a PLA is because it gives them access to apprentices that they may not otherwise have. Okay, you have to, if you have a registered apprenticeship program, you are able to maybe have a better bid on your work because apprentices can work a little at a lower wage based on their experience. You can only get that through a PLA unless you have your own apprenticeship program.
Hang on, I'm going to let Senator Comrie just say hello, okay, and then we're going to open it up to all kinds of questions, because my guess is PLAs, it's more than just a question.
Right. I just wanted to weigh in as well. Senator Roback started firing questions about the key component of the PLA, but I wanted to echo the sentiments of Senator Croce regarding the issues of small business and MWBE and how these design-build contracts are negotiated. I think there needs to be a very clear process and a standard that is set that's understandable and to ensure that there is not favoritism done. The reason why we've been pushing the design and design bid and build is to make sure that there was more transparency, more allowances for smaller contractors. We're trying to work now to make sure that small contractors can get the capital and the financing done to be able to be competitive bidders. We don't want to lose that. And, you know, design build, the fear is, some reports have come back that it's pushed out minority opportunity for participation. I want to see that could be corrected. There is a need, you know, being a former city council member who still has about $12 million in unspent money that I put in the city council for capital projects. I understand the need to get projects done, and especially now that I'm gone, the city that projects that they did not like or they're not working to push to get done, you know, which is needed in my community. So I see both sides and all sides of this problem. But we definitely need to have a standardization so that there's no fear of non-government participation. I'm concerned with how the governor has laid out this project to give ultimate authority to only a certain set of people with no oversight, but I think the minds around this table, except for maybe one, could work this out.
Senator, I just want to respond to something that you said, if you don't mind, and Tracy mentioned it too, about how does design build impact smaller and mid-sized firms. When this arrived in 2011, there was a lot of anxiety in the industry about that very point, because a lot of our members are everybody. You've got the big guys that you would recognize from the city, and then you've got small family-owned businesses around the state. And folks thought, oh no, you're going to have these mega contracts that only the real big multinational or huge firms are going to be able to do, and we're going to have the scraps. Your local companies, the folks that you know, Senator Kennedy, had this concern. The reality has been it hasn't been the case. I think that, you know, the DOT has done a good job of sort of parceling these out. You don't want to do a tiny job design build, but they've bundled them in a way with input from the industry that has made them manageable for the local contractors that are part of the community around the state, that employ the local folks around the state, and that fear largely has not been realized. And I think that, you know, again, the department deserves credit for managing it in a way that allowed those firms to do it. On the MWBE angle, you know, our experience has been on PLAs that it makes it much more difficult than it already is to get MWBE participation. There's a contract under procurement right now in the Syracuse area where there's a mandated PLA, where we're hearing from the contractors there that they are getting responses from the MBEs that they would usually try to do business with in that space. There's a PLA, we can't do it. They're having a very difficult time because many of those firms are non-union, and the PLA on the job makes it very difficult for them to be part of the project.
Why isn't the PLA fully factored in the cost of the project as opposed to an after cost? That's just confusing me. Why isn't it done prior to and as part of the beginning cost of the project? Because it seems to me the PALs are negotiated after the contractor or the developer gets the final cost of the project. It seems to me that it's acting against the ability of the project to get done. And how can we make that change?
Toes that maybe my toes should not be in, because the City of New York does not have the same issue, I think, as the state entities above us. We have had a PLA in place for 7 years now, mm-hmm. and I call them my second generation PLA, will actually be expiring in 2018. And that will be a complete 8-year period of time. Our project labor agreements are in place already before we actually go out and do our bids. So every potential bidder, contractor out there that's looking at our projects, knows and understands that the project they're bidding on has the project labor agreement. They have a copy of the project labor agreement so they can understand exactly what it is that they're going to be buying into. And so the issue is that
project labor, the standards in that agreement are consistent, because I think I heard you say that there's a mandated PLA versus a negotiated PLA, and the numbers are different in each category. Why can't we just get a standard agreement that everyone would know what the numbers are?
New York City has a standard agreement. But so it's not our issue. I'm not sure what they're referring to.
And in New York City, the whole public works market is union. You don't have an open shop industry down there that's doing public work. So you don't have the same competitive issues in the city that you have around the state.
I think I disagree.
I disagree with that as well.
I have a lot of minority contractors that are coming to me saying that over the last 5 years with design build, they're not getting in. So I don't know who's creating the statistics or where the analysis is coming from. But I would hope that there is some real analysis that could give us a real feedback on it. But I'm still hung up on why isn't there a standard. I did send a letter to support the city getting design built to the governor and to the leader of the Senate. But having standards and having consistency and having transparency, I think, is the major issues that would help cleaning up for everybody. And making sure that there's that we don't lose government jobs behind this as well, and civil service jobs, and for people that have already done the job at a high level. I'm concerned about contractors that would have to cut dollars or cut the ability to provide a quality project because they're getting squeezed on the back end by mandated costs as well. So I think that there's some conversation that needs to happen all around.
With respect to the PLAs impacting the cost of the job, under the Court of Appeals decision, the state or a public entity cannot enter into a PLA unless it's supported by a feasibility study which shows that it would save money. So what usually happens is a independent person is hired to conduct a study. They will usually reach out to the trades to see what kind of concessions the trades would consider under a PLA. For the most part, your PLA is standard. It's a standard document, and then just certain terms and conditions get negotiated. And usually it depends on market, on what part of the state you're in as to what those terms are. But only if that independent study determines that there is a savings will a PLA be required on the job, because that's going to save the taxpayers money. Now, there are cases where the state has opted, for example, not to do a PLA. The project goes to bid. An example would be the Crown Point Bridge, okay? That went to bid. Mm-hmm. The winning contractor, Flatiron, came in and said, we want the PLA. We know that we need it to build this job effectively and on time. And so that PLA ended up being negotiated, and all those savings went into the private contractor's pocket instead of the state. So there can be PLAs negotiated afterwards, but usually it is beforehand so that the contractors, including MWBEs, can factor that price into their bid. And like I said, with the MWBEs, under a PLA, they would have access to apprentices. So they could possibly be more competitive on the job because they can factor in that wage in their bid.
I'm sorry, Madam Chair. I'm going to take us back a step or two here
and bring us out broader, but I would be remiss not to introduce my colleagues, Rebecca Wood in Council and Tim Atkins in Finance. And my guess is you all know them very well, but I want to make sure I thank them for all the hard work. And I'm going to bring us a little broader. I think we talk about maybe some of the projects that we've done, some of the cost savings, and get a little debate on the costs, get into the transparency issue, which I think is huge when it comes to the RFQs and the RFPs. Do we like it? Do we not? Then get into some of the PLA issues, because I think PLAs will have, I don't want to save it for the end when we're tired, but so Ron, I'm going to ask you to be, since you really are, you could just give us an example and why you think they've worked or when you've chosen not to use them.
So I think the CAPER is the Kosciuszko Bridge, if I got that right, because I can never say it correctly. That's a good example of a project that I referenced earlier in the discussion about. Not only shouldn't you look at the direct cost savings, you should look at the time. First of all, look at the environment that you're working in. So what it allowed you to do was to basically accelerate the construction of that project in a condition which is highly congested. And yet it's a critical network serving the airport, serving freight, serving local communities. That project alone saved 42 months by going the design build route. So that's 42 months of inconvenience that the public will not experience as a result of that project. And that's really kind of what I want to get back to, is that, you know, I've heard a lot of things discussed, and it sounds like all we're going to do is design build. And I go back to my opening statement, which is we probably have done 4,000 projects since the design build authorization was provided to the department. We've done 28 projects. There's a very rigorous process that these projects go through in terms of identification as well in terms of selection. There are not a bunch of engineers in a dark room just coming up with, you know, hey, I like this guy, let's do this, let's do that. There are evaluation criteria. The contractors know when they're bidding what that criteria is. The projects do get reviewed and approved by OSC. We have conversations with people who are not successful in their proposals after the fact, if they so choose, to explain some of the issues that they may have had with their proposals. So it's not done in secrecy. There is transparency. There is oversight in terms of, like I said, it was raised earlier that the construction inspectors are not off there working for the consultant. They do have to report back to the department. All of these people who are involved in putting together these proposals, they're licensed engineers. They're not going to risk their license. They're not going to risk their livelihood and expose themselves to the litigated risk by cutting corners. So I think we tend to overstate things to say our position, but it goes back to, you know, I can look at projects, you know, we did Call Straight Pass, the Rochester Intermodal Station. I mentioned the K Bridge, Route 110 in Suffolk County. We replaced a bridge over Route 27. We've got projects all across the state that are benefiting. And really what it comes down to is it's about the public's inconvenience and about getting these. Some of these projects would not have ever been built, let alone the fact that they're being built sooner, just because of the environment that they're in without this tool. And from my perspective, the key metric, again, is that we've done 28 projects. We've saved over 50 years of time in terms of, you know, the way we've approached this. That's invaluable. It's completely invaluable.
Please, yeah.
If I could just ask, too. So this is where I get confused. I think we all want work to go out the door and get it. But so I'm always told for shovel-ready projects, you know, locally, 390, 490 interchange, where more people go through there in Rochester than the Tappan Zee Bridge, go over it every day. But then when we get to the project, there seems to be this delay. So, I mean, my first question would be, when they say shovel ready, does that mean that work's already been done by? I always get the sense that the department's already done a little bit of the work to get it ready, and that we could go right almost to bidding construction. Is that not true?
That's not really the way it works. And I don't know where the shovel ready concept comes from, other than from the ARRA perspective. And let's put ARRA in the parking lot for now. We could talk about that, but that was a totally different set of rules that we had to operate under. But basically, the whole advantage of design build is that you're not basically bringing this to a certain percentage of design in-house and then turning it over to a contractor or design firm who have to figure out what to do with what you've done. You're basically giving them the ability, you're unleashing the innovation And basically, that's what the design build does, is allows a contractor to come back and propose things that either you don't have expertise in, you haven't thought of. It allows you to do things, like I said, slide in bridge decks, things that we just haven't been able to do ourselves. They come back to the table and offer us these new and innovative approaches that we sit there and say, this is a really good idea.
I think that's good. Just one more question, then I'll be done. I was just curious, because I do think that you can merge these things and get to a good spot. I don't know if this question's for Paul or for you, Ron. I don't understand, because it seems to me it would be cheaper, because you already have the expertise and the people there. Did you ever talk to the governor's proposal of why DOT, who has a whole department that checks these projects, has the expertise, why wouldn't they just let them do it? And then no matter what the criteria was, that cost is already kind of in the system, because you already have the expertise, and then you would stay away from ever any dialogue of any conflict of interest if anything, God forbid, wasn't up to par, or we had an incident, as has happened in other states. This would insulate that, and I would think remove the cost.
So I think I like to view this as, when you approach the Tappan Zee Bridge, when you end up with this merge of like 18 lanes, into like three, So, and what we're doing is we're taking a lot of issues that really have independent utility that are not necessarily attached to design build, like PLA was mentioned, and the labor force issue was mentioned. They really should be treated separately, because we are not replacing our existing labor force by using design build. What we're doing is we're augmenting the fact that we may not have the type of resource that we need, because sometimes we don't have the, it's a civil service system. We may not have the expertise on staff. And so that's a reason why you wouldn't want to go out and augment. The other thing is we have a program of projects now that is 25 projects that we're working on. You typically don't staff up for your maximum project load. You staff up for a basically level type of program. And so what you do is you have additional needs that we use regular consultant engineering sources for meeting design bid build. And it's the same thing here. We're using additional consultant resources for design build to augment, but not to replace. It's just, it's the way you manage your labor force. You would not staff your personal business with the maximum labor you need for the high watermark, as opposed to what your, kind of routine requirements are.
So how do you feel about the $1.2 million threshold? I was surprised as I was learning about this, $1.2 million on a road project goes like this, right? And I have worked with the regional DOT, and they are more than capable of handling a small road project.
Right. So I actually don't necessarily look at value. One of my issues is that it could be a $1.2 million project, but it could be a very challenging environment. So what I look at is, what is the problem you're trying to solve, not necessarily how much is the project. And sometimes we may not have the expertise for that $1.2 million or whatever the issue is. I'm using that as the example you proposed, but that's what it's about.
So it really is the complexity of the project.
It's the complexity. Maybe it requires innovation. Like there was the Dingle Road Bridge down in the Hudson Valley, where basically by using innovation, they were able to, instead of taking a bridge out of service for years, kind of pre-construct it off-site and then slide it in over a weekend. You look for those kinds of innovative techniques so that you don't hang up the public for years and years on end.
And I'm going to ask, and then I promise to allow my colleagues. So why, I had bundling then.
Yes.
Why bundle?
So it's about efficiency. We're not bundling different types of activities. Sometimes what you're doing is in the same geographic location, you have very similar needs. And just, you get efficiency out of, in terms of bid pricing. If you do three or four, you're going to get better pricing than one. And then doing another one, then doing another one. And what it allows you to do is they might be able to come back and give you a solution for those four particular bridges that you hadn't thought of on your own. But it really is about doing very similar type work in a constrained environment and doing it much quicker than you could otherwise.
I know, I can see he's jumping out of his chair. Yeah, please.
So in theory, it is the right approach based on most effective use of your resources. But the practice over the last 4 years and the 28 projects has not shown that. For example, Kosciuszko Bridge is a good example, $500 million, or chance for innovation. Majority of the projects that have been bundled and the scope of work of those projects, bridge deck replacements, bridge superstructure replacements, pipe culverts, including where you slide in bridge decks. That could all be done by state forces. The DOT has the expertise to do that. Granted, if DOT had the staffing that it was to do those on all those projects, that'd be even better.
So again, I fully respect your position on this. I don't mean to be argumentative, but I do want to say some of the bundled projects that have been raised were actually done for, you know, different reasons. One of the most prevalent uses of bundling that we've done has to do with our scour program. We have a critical bridges over water program. Governor secured over $500 million from the FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, to harden and protect bridges all around the state, especially upstate, from severe, you know, weather patterns that we've had and the flooding that we've had, and everybody's aware of the Mohawk Valley flooding. And so there was a present, you know, example of where we needed to get done really quickly, because the longer it took us to get that done, the more susceptible we were to future, you know, flooding scenarios that would cause not only harm to people's livelihood and to their personal property, but in some cases even, you know, their lives.
Please.
He's brought up a couple times now talking about why it takes so long and how can we fix the problem. You know, I've heard the words transparency, accountability, and making sure that people know what they're proposing on and that everyone understands the standards. Again, I understand I'm New York City, I'm not the state, I'm not some of the counties or the state agencies. But in New York City, we have a procurement system in place that is now approaching its 30th year. And when we created the Procurement Policy Board, it's a 5-member board that took the model procurement code from the ABA and took, which has been vetted by lawyers in the world of government and procurement, going back actually to the 1970s. And we took those rules and we put them into our book. And it's a fairly thick book. And the reason why it takes 1 to 2 years to bring on a design firm or 1 to 2 years to bring on a contractor is because in here we have everything laid out from the time period of when you advertise and how long you advertise. And then when people ask questions and then you amend and postpone the bid date or the proposal date, it's all laid out here. And so everybody who ever wants to propose on New York City projects, and if you haven't, I would urge you all, if those that are contractors or even design professionals, we have everything on our website. So for example, if you went to my website, you can look at every contract that I've awarded since 2014. I love FOIL, I'm the FOIL officer in my agency. I've taken part of my workload and I've put it onto the website. So at any time, anybody can look at a contract that I have awarded since 2014, and I'm working with my IT team and we're slowly going back in time. In addition, RFPs, which is what we're talking about with design build. We've heard best value, we've heard transparency. Again, my agency and the agencies in the city of New York, our RFPs are on our website, closed and open. So if you want to see what a design build RFP looked like, if I had the ability to design build, you could go on their website and see exactly what the criteria was. What was it that this agency was asking for? What were the evaluation criteria? And it's all extremely clear. And if it's not clear, we have precise directions in our documents, and I believe State DOT has the same as well, saying if you don't understand something, ask. We get those questions all the time. We take those questions, we vet them, we then turn around and we issue a document, not to the firm that asked the question, but to everybody that signed up to pick up an RFP. And then finally, and again, I'll say something that the city does, I think other places do it in the state, we have a series of contracting professionals. And we're all in government, for most of us, and we all know how much we love our acronyms. And so for us, our acronym is, we have somebody called the CHPO, the City Chief Procurement Officer. And this person is the director of the Mayor's Office of Contracts. All RFPs, even from an agency like myself, which is all we do RFPs and bid documents, those RFPs have to be reviewed and vetted by the Mayor's Office of Contracts, which is by the CHPO. Every agency then has an ACCO, an Agency Chief Contracting Officer. And this person and their team is trained. Not only are they trained in the PPB rules, but we have something called the Procurement Training Institute. And everybody who works in procurement has to go through and understand whether we're talking about a competitive sealed bid, whether we're talking about a request for proposals. So if the city, and we do hope that the city gets the ability to do design build, there will be training on how we do design build, how the RFPs are going to look in a design build universe versus what they currently look right now for our general services. So I understand your frustration, and maybe it's a little bit faster in Rochester, But because of the way we've set up our system, we have put in place all of these time periods and rules, so everybody knows exactly what's happening. And we, oh, yes?
Yeah. Critical.
No, no, I understand.
Do you think all those are still relevant today from 1970 to today, or are there ones at your level, at the state level, that we can remove that are there for no collective good or unnecessary? And not to go back, see, I don't know, I don't work in the field, but to me, to have somebody with millions and millions of dollars at stake for a big project being able to hire who says if it's done right, that to me is kind of asking for trouble. Whereas if you have somebody whose sole job is independently to review it, that regulation makes sense to me and is one that I think you can make the argument protects the public or certainly increases the chances greater. And so my point was is I appreciate Elaine having the round table. There's been a lot of dialogue on where we're going to go with this. I almost think it's bigger than that too, where we may be able to get more streamlined in a number of ways perhaps now that we're talking about this at such large scale from the executive right to local governments and everybody in between. And I just don't know. You guys know it more than me. And then again, I realize that beauty's in the eyes of the beholder. What one person thinks is unnecessary, somebody else may think is very necessary. But what I found out, whether it's maybe law enforcement, which I'm more familiar with, or other things, there's usually a lot of things that got put in for a reason years ago that may not be relevant today, or something better could be put in place.
Right. No, it's a great point. And yes, I think all of us around this table would all agree that at some point there can be better streamlining of what the rules and the processes are. I believe design build is a really excellent step in that direction. And the concept of best value, which again is not done in a vacuum, and we heard from some of my colleagues, you know, these are people with their professional licenses on the table. They're looking at these, making decisions, and it's not just one person or two people or three people. This is a group of people who are trained in how to review proposals and to make the best educated decision based on a number of factors.
Yeah, I think it's very important to recognize that, you know, I'm going to repeat myself again, design build is a tool. It is not the prevalent method in terms of which we do our business. It is far from that. It does get people to work quicker. But my biggest fear is that we've talked about, I've heard a lot of issues, I've taken a lot of notes today. A lot of the things I've heard really are independent of design build, but we're kind of attaching these issues to it. We normally do that in government because this is a measure for which we can attach our own personal interests. But I think we need to deal with design build as design build and deal with some of the other issues separately. Otherwise, we'll end up in a situation where I think none of us will be served well.
And that's great, but what about in this would be permanent, okay? So what about in 10 years or 20 years? We don't know who's going to be there. And what about at the county level and in some of these other agencies? I mean, some states actually have, you know, you can only do design build if you get approval. You know, like I think DOT has standard authorization, but in order to get other projects through, you just have to go through a procurement officer of some kind to make sure it's an appropriate project. I don't know if that would be the right path or not. I'm just saying that some states recognize that you can't always depend on the agencies with authorization to do the right thing.
You can set this up. I will say that New York has typically lagged behind the rest of the nation in terms of just how we approach design build and other procurement techniques. It's just there are, you know, 40 some odd states, nearly 50 states that have stronger design build and other procurement. You've mentioned a few, Mike, and so we're catching up.
Brian, would you give me 1 second?
Yeah, of course.
So Senator DeFrancisco has joined us. And the senator represents the Syracuse area. Can I describe it as that, sir?
That's correct.
You for joining us. Thank you, Brian.
So, you know, one of the things that when you look at what goes on at the federal level, the federal design build procurement legislation is 2 pages. It's very straightforward. It's very simple. One of the things that could go a long way towards making New York's better is that in your RFQ or your request for proposal, you state very clearly that whatever you submit in your design package will be a part of the public record. You establish the groundwork right from the very beginning. So there isn't any confusion then in the public's eye because everything is transparent. And you can do this, and Mike and I have talked about this, you can do this in two different ways. So you have a technical aspect of your bid, and then you have the pricing aspect. You can release the technical aspects of the bid to the public, let them review it, and then you can, you know, after you unseal the bids and you pick the winner, you can then release your scoring documents. I mean, that it's a very easy way, and a lot of other states do that.
Right. Sounds pretty simple. Any comments on that particular point?
Senator, if you would allow me to address you and respectful of everybody's position here, I think we're coming at this from a little bit of a different perspective. And I'm not certain that everybody understands the roots of the Office of General Services Design and Construction Group. We used to be partnered with DOT back in the day when we were the Department of Public Works. And they took their path, we took our path on the building side. We currently do not have design build capabilities whatsoever as far as our enabling legislation is concerned. However, under the public buildings law, on a number of fronts, we are charged with responding to the over 50 clients, if you will, executive agencies that we serve and authorities to respond to their building needs. This also includes emergencies as well. So we unfortunately are not at the table in the budget making process to determine which projects may be good candidates for design build. Thus, you know, the support to be able to have the authority or the broad authority based on our experience to vet appropriately those projects that may fit. It's not the way we want to do business. We're advocating for one more tool in our toolbox, if you will, so that we could respond not only in emergency situations, but in those situations that present themselves where there's a public interest that requires a rapid response, in addition to the criteria that would be set forth by statute. A number of things that I've heard that were addressed here in terms of transparency, the WICS law, PLA, quality, and project audit. Our experience, just limited experience that mentioned earlier, in terms of transparency, every project that we do is approved by the Office of the State Comptroller. The State Comptroller has a bucket list of things. They're developing their design build criteria in terms of the evaluations that need to be done. They've partnered with DOT, and we've had dialogue with them most recently as it relates to, you know, what is the documentation that's required. It becomes foilable, it becomes public, and there is a certain degree of transparency in that process. So they're going to look at it again after we've done the things that we need to do to be sure that we're following in that regard. Also, Commissioner DeStito chairs the Council of Contracting Agencies. We most recently have set up a subcommittee in the council to deal with design build as a potential tool, to study it, to partner with DOT and some of the other agencies, the Dormitory Authority, State University Construction Fund, the Bridge Authority, in order to standardize, if you will, or at least to begin a dialogue of standardization of the process so that the process becomes a documented process. It's one that we follow and that we all agree is appropriate in that regard. So I think we can address the ability of transparency. In terms of WICS, on our experience with the South Beach project, we mandated in the contract that separate contracts be let for those that were specific to heating, plumbing, and electric, in addition to the up to other 20 contracts that were let. I heard this a little bit earlier, we administratively and put in the form of our contract with that contractor then that we have the right to audit that process. And we actually had a third party, Toski and Schaefer at the time, audit firm that went in there and was sure that there was appropriate advertisement, there were appropriate bids that were received, that the documentation supported the recommendation to us to award their packages. So we covered that in that regard. In terms of quality, we have, and as DOT does, we have field inspectors. We have staff that addresses the quality of the installation and the work. At the end of the day, we have the power of the purse. If we feel that that the work doesn't meet the quality standards or the expectations that we have, then at that point, we can withhold payment until such time where there's corrections that need to be made, and I think we routinely do that.
where it's appropriate. So there is an audit component in any way, shape, or form on the multiple parts of as design build progresses or any construction project. So, and I'll leave the PLA as an argument, as a separate argument, because obviously in our case, a study needs to be conducted. And if the study yields, you know, savings, then considerations are made and we move in that direction. So what we're looking for here in some cases, being able to, in most cases, is to be able to respond to the public need as it relates to our enabling authority under the legislation that says we have to respond. Department of Corrections, as Molly mentioned earlier, state police, OASIS, Office of Mental Health, these are all clients that have to come to us. We do their work. Even DEC, for that matter, and some of the other agencies that had the previous enabling legislation, we didn't. So we couldn't even parlay that into responses to assist them in their infrastructure. We just don't do bridges. We also do water projects, water mains, sewage treatment facilities on behalf of these executive agencies. So the perspective that we come to you with is a little bit different in that we're looking for this to be another tool in the toolbox that we have in order to respond to the needs of the taxpayer.
Do you have specific projects, John, that you can give us examples of now that are in the pipeline that design build?
We currently don't have the legislation, so there are some projects that would fall into that category that we think we could go back and study to see if they would be good candidates and provide that for
and,
that.
And you said something about a study. It always scares me when I hear government's going to study something, you know, years from now. But training, when it comes to training, and Ron, I'm going to ask you to address this too, you know, what type of training goes in place for those employees, those individuals that can make the decision on design build, and would you duplicate what they do, obviously with little nuances, given that they're different type of projects?
Well, the first thing is we collaborate very closely with the other agencies, and actually we even use OGS for some of our building needs, so correct. It's not like we're completely independent. I got a lab, by the way, you can put on your list.
I understand.
But the truth of the matter is we have some of our best and most senior people who are part of the review and evaluation process. These are not junior individuals. They come with national credentials. They serve on all kinds of national committees. They have their certification renewals. These are, you know, really the upper echelon. And they are the ones who put together the materials, and they're teaching the people who work for them, you know, in terms of the training, how to better, you know, look at projects. So we build the bench so that as they leave, that we have a group of individuals who can come in after them. We also take advantage of national training opportunities and collaboration with other states. There's all kinds of things that we do to keep up on the current state of practice.
And we think, as our role as the chair of the council, that we get to share that information amongst us to develop this, if you will, standardization. And you know, it's another delivery method for us that isn't the end-all be-all, as he mentioned, but it's certainly one that would be appropriate to work in response to, you know, the way we need to respond. We don't have the first instance opportunity to sit at DOB and say, here's a good candidate, here's a good candidate, here's a good candidate. DOB deals directly with our client agencies, and they then ultimately come to us once their budgets are passed with the projects that they have. So then we have to sort of think about what's the best delivery, you know, method that we have available to them. We use tools like cost plus percentage fee. We have a very sophisticated audit staff that deals with these on our emergency contracts and our standard contracts. We've used everything that we have in terms of the legal ability that we have to deliver these projects, which traditionally is design, bid, build, but there's certain nuances in contract that we can address that with. But, you know, overall, again, you know, the process for us would be, it's another tool in the toolbox in order to respond, because literally we could go back to the office and have a $40 million building that's coming over from the Department of Corrections or the Department of Homeland Security or whomever, and we need to respond to their needs so that they can meet their mission or their core missions appropriately. So we're advocating for the tool.
And I'd additionally just like to add, we do have a very sophisticated procurement shop within design and construction, where obviously we do the low responsive bid on the construction side of contracts, but we also do qualification-based procurement for design consultants that we partner with. And additionally, we already do, we have familiarity with best value procurements because our construction managers that we partner with are best value. So the, from scoring and ranking and the process of process and procedure of procurement, we do have a shop that then brings in resources from design and construction that are subject matter experts, if you will, in types of procurements that we would be going out for.
Senator DeFrancisco.
I have a totally different topic. So we're at one more.
So let's stay on the topic for a second. Sure.
Mr. Epstein, do you have a set of practices and standards like Mr. Baroli's mentioned?
The department does have this.
And it's available to the public?
It is on our website, yes.
It's on your website?
And the industry is well aware of it, labor is well aware of it.
Right. So there is a standard that you've been developing and refining.
Yes.
Regarding design build. Do you have a statistics on MWBE or veterans participation?
I personally don't have a statistic with me today, but I would offer, without trying to get in trouble here, that's a bigger issue than just design build.
Right.
And I think we need to deal with the availability in general.
Yeah. Okay. Wanted to just finally agree with everything Senator Roback said in his last statement. We do need to come up with a larger view of everything, because things that have been put in place 40 years ago are not now standards. And with the amount of infrastructure that needs to get repaired in the state and the need to do it quickly, there needs to be a better way to streamline some of these issues, definitely.
Right, and the department is fully committed to implementing the goal for WMBE. We need to work with our other agencies to build those list of eligible candidate contractors.
Good. Josh.
Okay. I want to ask about the mental health facility that was rebuilt after Superstorm Sandy. That was done under what authority? An executive order?
Correct.
Yes.
So for emergencies, you could have authority, is that correct?
Because you've done it, is that right?
No, it was. Thank you. We had a request that.
But you were okay. So you were granted it, though.
But we don't know that while the emergency is underway. We were faced with this disastrous condition, if you will, and inventoried what tools that we had available to us, and then slowly, the phone starts ringing in terms of where is the damage, what needs to be done, and ultimately, once the project was identified, then. It was incumbent on us to go back and approach the chamber, obviously, to get the authority that we thought we needed to do. Now, if that authority didn't come, then, that's the nuance here. You wait, and we don't have time to wait in some cases like that. So, ultimately, while you make a good point, it's just, what's the distinction in time between when you have to respond and you have to deliver. And that's just, I'm just speaking to that in the emergency basis.
Thanks.
I guess I just follow up on John's comment and also addressing something Molly said, and I believe also Senator, you asked this question when I first started talking about whether or not there's been a project-specific design build. I'm not sure I would call it design build, but I think I would call it probably design build light. My agency is kind of like what the old OGS was in the sense of that did DOT work as well as everything else, vertical versus horizontal. Everybody's familiar with, of course, September 11th, New York City. Port Authority is decimated. My small little agency was called upon that day to kind of step in and to assist. At the time, we thought it was going to be a recovery action, then became a debris removal project. When we first started at the World Trade Center, which was a 16-acre site, the original proposals or ideas or concepts we heard was it's going to take about 2 years to do it in the sense of cleaning it up, and it's probably going to cost a little over $2 billion. Well, what we did is a design build light process, and we brought in four very large construction managers to assist us in this operation immediately that day. We delivered that project in under 12 months, and the cost was under $800 million. And it was an achievement not just of DDC, but it was really an achievement of the private and the public sector, both the public employees as well as the private sector employees. And it was an incredible experience for me professionally. My office was my daughter's classroom. We took over PS 89. Which is a public school in Barry Park City, and that's where we operated out of for 6.5 months before we changed our office space to one of the World Financial Center buildings. But here was an example of, and again, no one wants to be waiting for an emergency to happen to then have access to a tool that, as we've already discussed, the rest of the nation has. following what happened with 9/11, the city recognized we needed to do more and better training of our police to handle this type of scenario. So my agency, working with the police department, was asked and tasked to design and build a police academy, which we gladly embraced. And in College Point, Queens, I'd like to say today, there is a police academy. But that project took almost 8+ years. And if we had design build, we believe that police academy could have been up and running and online years ahead of schedule. But because we had to go through this entire process of design, bid, and build, which I won't bore everybody again with the long process times, but it took a really long time to get there. Currently, I have a project, one of my sister agencies, DOT, to rebuild the BQE. The BQE has 21 bridges. It has a cantilevered, triple cantilevered roadway system. If we have to go by design, bid, build, my grandchildren will hopefully be able to use that highway when it's done. That's how long it's going to take. If we don't have design build to do the BQE project, we're talking not only years, but I'm going to say a decade plus to achieve a project, and I don't even know what the cost will be in 10 years from today. I have a few other projects in Rodman's Neck in the Bronx that, again, if I don't have design build, I don't know when these projects are going to be done and at what costs.
Thank you. So before we go off the issue of transparency when it comes to the RFQ, RFP, is there any other comments on, are they transparent? Do we feel that we have a system in place? Your suggestion, right?
You can make the current system better, and I think you do that by entertaining putting language in your RFQ that says, all documents submitted under this bid will be made public. Then it's up to the design team what they choose to put in their bid docs. Then you release the technical scores, and then you release.
And how do you feel about releasing the technical scores? Or, is there any issues? You're the one doing it, Ron, so.
Yeah. Thoughts about it today, because I haven't really considered that. My only concern would be, what do we do with proprietary, information such as, an innovative technique that might give their competitor?
The contractor would have to divulge in their bid specs that this is proprietary, and that would have to be redacted.
Redacted. Yeah. Right.
And I would suggest that there's a difference between releasing the proposal, because I'm honestly not sure what the public would gain from looking at the proposal. I mean, a lot of us talk about this every day. If we look at these proposals, would it make sense to you? Probably, it certainly wouldn't make sense to me. But I think what should happen is that, first, let me take a step back. The idea that somehow if you're doing design build, it's not competitively bid is wrong. It is competitively bid. It's just that the decision is made not simply on who was the lowest price. It's made on a process that looks at the price and the technical score. And they're weighted, and there's a clearly delineated set of rules, and it is what it is. And so there's that evaluation that Ron and others talked about of the technical score of the proposal, and then there's the price. Price is the price. That's a competitive bidding process. If it wasn't competitively bid, we as an association, AGC, and as an industry, who have fiercely defended the competitive bidding laws for decades, would be screaming from the rooftops about it. It's just a different process, right? The decision isn't made simply by the lowest number. I think you can achieve that transparency simply by, like you do on bid day, when there's a letting and they open up the bids and you have all the numbers and the lowest apparent bidder is whomever, congratulations. With design build, it should be a similar process where here is the price, here is the technical score, here is the overall score based on the weighted criteria, and it's pretty clear who won, right? Whoever had the best score, and everybody knows. And it's not only good for the public, because then the public knows why was that decision made. It eliminates the notion that somebody's trying to help somebody. And I think we all agree that transparency is a good thing, and there should be faith in the process. It's also good for the contractors, because right now, although they do debrief after the procurement, the unsuccessful contractors, they may know he did better than I did, but how much better did he do, right? I failed the test. Did I get a 64 or did I get a 20? How close was I? If you can see what your score actually was, it helps the industry too to the next time do a better job when they're proposing.
And
personally, I welcome the opportunity to have these conversations. I just want to make sure we do everything possible to protect proprietary information. Yep, only concern.
There is that level of transparency with the scoring system. It's still a subjective award, which is different than lowest responsible bidder, which is purely an objective reward. But that aside, The other aspect, again, is what type of contract is it? So if you have a lump sum contract that gets awarded under a design build contract, there's actually some confusion about whether or not, for example, does the contractor have to reveal his labor costs and information or not? If you look at in the governor's proposal, this is highlighted in the Consolidated Lab Act, where in one section it specifically says if they opt for the lump sum proposal, this information does not have to be revealed. And in another part of the bill, it says this is a public work that must comply with Article 8 of the labor law. Well, that requires certified payrolls to be submitted. So do we submit the payroll information or do we not? And that's where we're concerned about transparency, and especially in that kind of situation is where we would insist upon a PLA to make sure that the people that are building the project are protected.
So the wages and the benefits have to follow the scale, so there is no question on the labor side.
So, well, yes, assuming that it's done properly and assuming that the majority of contractors are on the up and up. There are times when it's not, and we see this in DOL all the time, but my concern is that this particular legislation on the Consolidated Lab, which is a design build bill as well, says you don't have to reveal labor costs.
Right.
So do you or do you have to submit the certified payrolls or not? So that's, I'm not saying that it's wrong or one way
something
or the other,
to
I'm
clarify.
Saying that it should be clarified. That's
sure.
Senator DeFrancisco.
Go ahead.
When the design build first came into effect, I was in support of it, and I still am, but my one concern was, since I did a lot of litigation in this area, is that for some instances where the design was going merrily along and somehow, because as was said before, the people with the money have the power over the purse strings, oftentimes there was a change in scope. And many of the contracts, you have to submit change orders. And if the change order isn't accepted or if the contractor, as often happens, well, you got to do this. Just do it or we're going to get somebody else. I suggested that we have to watch out for the possibility of an increase in the claims process, litigation process, because designs change over the time. And the subs and sometimes the general contractors get caught in the loop, either do it or we'll get somebody else. All I'm asking, and I don't need to have the information now since we have everybody in one room, if anybody has any examples or any information about whether that concern of mine was real now that we're into the design build business, I'd really like to find that out.
Well, I can tell you that from my experience that we haven't had an issue necessarily with change orders. We have had projects like the Rochester Station where we've added additional work. There was work that was discovered after we started the project, like the skylights on the bridge adjacent to the facility, where we negotiated, and there were provisions in the contract for negotiating additional elements. So there's a process by which not only we can add the work, they get paid a fair value for it, and if they don't like what we're doing, they can also appeal it. So I think the process is pretty well documented. I haven't seen it as a huge issue.
So I thought you were originally asking what my bracket was, so I'm glad you didn't. You said you had an unusual question.
The bracket
for the NCAA basketball.
I don't care. So
you're falling
NIT,
right?
Syracuse isn't in. I'm looking at the NIT bracket.
Okay, well, they are number one, and they are taking on that hideous Greensboro team. I also started out in commercial construction litigation. I worked for a construction law boutique firm, so very familiar with what you're describing, and it's an amazing business and process dealing with the claims and the change orders. From my research, and before you came in, I was a self-proclaimed geek. I read a lot of stuff, and I read a lot about design build and the history of design build. From everything I've read, and I think Ron probably confirmed this, is when you do design build, there's actually a reduction in claims. There's a reduction in change orders. And we've heard a little bit of conversation, and maybe not enough yet, on the whole WMBE process and small contractors. One of the benefits of having a reduction in claims and change orders is you really are reducing what I think is the worst part of public procurement and public contracting. Our ability to make payments fast on change orders is not fast. Our ability to make payments quickly on contract work is very, very good. But when we get into the issue of change orders, when you're dealing with the multiple levels, and it's all good, it's all there for reasons, of audits and checks and balances, it really slows down the process. And as we all know, cash is king. And the ability to have cash flow is imperative, whether you're dealing with a small MWB firm or even dealing with a large contractor, because nobody wants to be basically financing a project. So if you can reduce claims, and design build has been shown to reduce claims, you are really assisting in the cash flow.
We have 10 minutes. We started on time. I promised we'd end on time. Let's talk about PLAs again. I don't think we can leave without talking about them. And I'm going to let somebody start. But we have to talk about it.
I think it's been made pretty clear our position from the contracting community side. I think labor's made their position pretty clear. I mean, we will always fundamentally disagree on project labor agreements and the pros and the cons. We believe they are anti-competitive. We believe that they are discriminatory in their nature on who is actually able to win the work. And we don't believe that at the end of the day, it's right for the taxpayers of the state of New York. So I think that's one of these issues that we're just not going to likely agree upon. But from our perspective, what we would, like to see, is when you do design, and design build and PLA are not mutually beneficial. They don't work well together. Because the nature of design build is you put the team around the table, and the team starts with the design, and then it goes into the engineering, and then you get your bid docs, and everybody knows their role. The PLA is always done after. So they're not, so some of those efficiencies that you could have acquired under the design build process are lost now on the backside because of the introduction of the PLA.
And just a couple points I would add.
I apologize, but they deserve their.
Yeah. The only thing I would say to that is these big projects, these marquee projects that have been so talked about it being so successful, like the Tappan Zee Bridge or the Quasco Bridge. Yeah, the K Bridge, it's easier to say. Both have had PLAs attached to them, and there has been a great cost savings because of the project labor agreement, not just design build.
And this may sound strange coming from my mouth. There are times a PLA can make sense. The Tappan Zee Bridge is a great example of where it made sense. But to blanketly mandate that you have to go through the study, which is very easy to find a way to justify the savings. I mean, when we talk about transparency and lack of manipulation, that is not the PLA study. They are easily manipulated. They are not transparent. So, but there are instances where a PLA will make sense.
So would you support a proposal which authorizes either the public agency or contractors in the course of utilizing design build to only use out-of-state union labor if they were unable to obtain in-state? If you have a PLA, it requires a certain amount of union labor. We don't have them in New York State.
Correct. So what happens is, if under a PLA, if the local union hall, right, doesn't have the labor force, they will go to another local and bring in what are called travelers.
Right.
Those travelers are not from the area.
Right.
And they are not taxpayers, your constituents. That's the problem with PLAs, is when that labor market is tapped, which it happens in quite a bit, and the reason we're seeing one-to-one PLAs in Buffalo is because the union market is tapped. 70%+ of the construction market, which is not union, will not be able to work on those projects. Okay.
So, first of all, the one-to-one ratio in Buffalo has been there for as long as I can remember, I think since Buffalo's first PLA. So it's not because the market is tapped, I would argue. Second of all, I would disagree generally that design build and PLAs do work very well together. Design build is especially useful perhaps if you have a complicated project, and that's exactly when a PLA is most beneficial, because you have these complications where if you standardize the terms and conditions, you're going to make sure that the project runs more smoothly. And
it's simply just not true that non-union contractors cannot compete under a PLA. The Court of Appeals has said that. Okay, we know that they can compete under a PLA because some bid and win.
Sure.
Okay, so it's not that they're locked out. So I just want to make the point that, you know, under a PLA, you have access to a steady workforce. If the market does get tapped out, the beauty of the PLA is that you have an assurance that you can get skilled labor from other parts of the state, people that you know are going to be trained.
But would you support using the out of state?
No, I would. You would never need to. If you had a PLA, you would never need. I mean, look at down in the Hudson Valley region where we are doing the Tap and Z. There are a lot of projects going on there right now under PLAs, and actually the market is. You know, they are able to supply the workers, but if they didn't, we could send in people from the city, you could send in people from the Albany area, and you would know that they were trained through apprenticeship programs and were qualified.
But the local taxpayers around the Tappan Zee that have made a choice not to be signatory to a collective bargaining don't get to work.
That's their choice.
Just a couple of points, Senator, if I could, on behalf of the union side of the industry. You know, our experience has been, particularly, again, since this is, you talk about DOT and design build, highway contractors are a little different in that they have typically have a large workforce, they self-perform. While legally, you're correct that they could bid under a PLA, in practice, they're not, very rarely are they going to do it. There are very few non-signatory contractors that will bid under a PLA because they want to have their own workforce. There's the benefits issue. Every PLA is a little bit different. But that gets to the point that when you have a PLA, who's negotiating it, right? For our union contractors who work with the trades and the men and women of the trades, very skilled, are their workforce, and they've worked successfully for a long time. When there's a mandated PLA, there's an agreement being negotiated by the agency and the trades. The contractor gets it.
Well, the trades represent the workers, so that's what a collective bargaining agreement does.
But a collective bargaining agreement is between the contractor, the employer, and the worker. When there's a PLA, the contractors and those who negotiate those agreements that are being deviated from with the PLA aren't in the room.
But the owner has every right to dictate the terms of how they want their job to take place. So that's why it's done that way.
Wouldn't you have a better agreement if the industry was part of that conversation? And then to the point of transparency, we've actually foiled the PLA studies. You get a bunch of black sheets of paper. We got one recently from OGS relative to the Syracuse Fairgrounds. That wasn't redacted. It was first one ever. Credit to OGS for actually sharing it, because again, this should be public information. An important determination is being made based on these studies, and many of the savings that were implied that would result from the PLA were, we thought, hopeful at best. And we suggested to OGS that there should be an after-action study to actually look at what were the savings that were realized. I'm not sure that has happened, but I think that would benefit everybody. We want everyone to be able to compete. Our members that are union firms, our members that are non-union firms, and get the best price or the best value for the taxpayer. That's what's right for everybody. Right now in the Syracuse area, the Thruway is getting ready to do their first design build project. They're doing a due diligence study on the PLA, which we've talked about this. This is an area of the state where for the Thruway, in that scope of work, 82 or 83% of the firms that have done that work are non-union firms. What's going to happen to who's going to do that work if there's a PLA? Because those firms that typically do it, they're not going to propose on that.
But that is their choice. If a PLA is going to be in the best interest of the taxpayers, then the state has every right to insist that a PLA be on the job, and it's up to the contractors who whether or not they want to bid on it. They're certainly entitled to do so.
But why would a contractor bid on a project where the workforce that they have developed, trained, educated, paid salaries and paid benefits for, bid that job when they can't go to work?
Some of them can, just like not all
some.
Of the union can. Okay, well, just saying. I mean, again, this is a fundamental disagreement, and we're not going to solve it here, and we both have our own.
Any comment on this?
We represent the non-union.
And our membership is 50-50.
You're going to stay out? Okay. I just want to see it. Any other? It is 11.
Thoughts. All I can say is for the New York City proposal, we have PLAs, we have mandated PLA language, it's not an issue for us. In addition to respond to Paul's earlier comments, we also have no issues with labor. DC 37 fully supports our proposal for design build. So hopefully that bought you some time, Ron.
No, like I said, I'm really going to leave this up to the unions, the trades, and the contractors. DOT has done studies for our design-build projects where it's made sense. We've moved forward with them. We'll continue to do our due diligence.
And I would suggest that I think government would look at these PLAs, make sure that they are in the beginning of the contract and not at the end, where the pressure is put on the contractor to still try to deliver the cost of a contract, and working outside agreements that would impact those costs, I think, is a problem. So the issue of, you know, whether there's a union workforce or non-union workforce or local workforce versus a non-local workforce is issues that need to be discussed at another forum. You know, clearly there are issues with, you know, in my community, people are always complaining that they don't see any of their local people working on the job. So that's always going to be an issue. That's always going to be a problem. Hopefully it's one that we can resolve.
Thank you, Sam.
You can always allow projects to be bid with or without a PLA, and let the lowest bid win.
So thank you. Thank you very much for the discussion, for the information. I think I'll speak on behalf of my colleagues. I think we walk away from this with a better understanding of your thoughts, and we'll move forward from here. So thank you very much.